Hello and welcome to Breaking Bread with Bishop. I'm so glad that you have decided to join us again. Please do me a favor. Text someone, call someone, share this message. We're here to empower you, to impart into you, and to share with you this message on this evening. Before I get started, I want to say happy birthday to Walteria Spaulding. That's my eldest sister and music director at Union Baptist Church. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. I just want to say happy birthday to you. Listen, we have a very interesting subject matter tonight. We're going to be talking about how to confront a racist Christian. That's what we're talking about tonight. How to confront a racist Christian. Racism is front and center again. And all in this week, Angel Mama, syrup, pancake mix, after 130 years, is off the shelf. It's coming off the shelf, and I got a feeling that Uncle Ben's rice is right behind it. 130 years history, finally, is off the shelf. NASCAR made some hard decisions, and thank God for the race car driver who took a bold stand and decided that he was going to name his car Black Lives Matter. The NASCAR decided that no longer would the Confederate flag fly there at the races, and we applaud them for that. Last year, right here in the city of Winston-Salem, we took a bold stand from this congregation, along with other pastors and leaders in our city, to change the name of our fair, the Dixie Classic Fair, because of the history of that name and its attachment to a racist history, a racist name. And so we led that movement from right here in this church and this congregation, not knowing that all of this will be taking place this year. A year to this date, really, did that movement start. And so then now, here we are. We're still dealing with racial matters. And then the heat of George Floyd, and then Breonna Taylor, and then so many others that are now bringing this whole racial issue back to the forefront. And the question remains, is it possible to even be a Christian and be racist? Don't be so quick to answer that, because I want to walk you through a lesson on this, during this message, and hopefully you'll engage and know how to confront a racist Christian. There are some books I want to share with you, and there's one book in particular. I think you ought to get this book. It's a book entitled The Dog Whistle Politics. This book is loaded with great information and history that is just broken down for you to understand the importance of how race is involved in politics and the history of that. So it's a great piece that you should read. But I want to go forward now and talk about how to confront a racist Christian. First, let's define what racism is. Okay, let's define what racism is. And I'm just going to kind of work from some notes here. First of all, racism is the belief that one race is superior over the other. One race is superior over the other. That is the belief of racism, the foundation of racism, that I am more superior over you because of my skin color or because of genetics, all right? And you'd be surprised of the number of people who believe that they are more superior over you because of their genetics. One writer once said that, Jane Elliott once said that we learn to be racist, therefore we can learn not to be racist, because racism has to deal with power and control. And so then now, if we are people who learn to be in power, learn to be in control, then we can unlearn power and unlearn control. Well, some believe that that's very debatable. And so they may say, well, that's not possible. But then that's one definition of racism. I like this definition of racism, particularly as an African-American man, because most African-Americans have had two life-altering experiences. The moment that they realized that they were black, and then the moment that they realized that it was a problem. I don't know about you, but I have had that moment when I realized that I was black, and then I had that moment when I realized that it was a problem. I never forget when I was in school at Elon University, and it was a great school, great college, great people there. But I never forget that when I was in class, and I went to one class, and the professor was calling out the name, and my name is Sir Walter Mack. That is my name. I was named after my father, and my father, his father named him Sir Walter Mack because my grandfather, his father, wanted to attach greatness to his name. And so I went to class, and the professor stood up and was calling out the roll on that particular day. And as he got to my name, he said, Sir Walter Mack. And I said, present. He said, Sir Walter Mack. I said, present. He said, what do you go by? I said, what do you mean, Sir Walter Mack? He said, you mean I have to call you sir? I said, yes, sir. And so the idea for him was that he could not conceive him calling me as a black man, sir. But that was my name. And that's what I made him call me, Sir Walter Mack. So then now, racism is when you realize, hey, that, hey, you are black. And then two, when it's a problem. And so then now I want you to watch this video. Procter & Gamble came out with a video called The Look. And I want you to see this because those of us who are African Americans, we have had an experience just like this. That's a powerful video. That's a powerful video. So let's talk about racism, and let's talk about that. So I'm going to try to keep a very complicated subject matter very simple for you in just a few minutes, okay? First of all, there are three types of racism that we can sort of digest tonight, right? First of all, there is systematic racism, and then there is implicit racism, and then there is hate racism. So I'm going to keep this very simple for you, and I'm going to break racism down into three forms, okay? systematic racism, implicit bias racism, and then hate racism. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And I just want to make sure that you understand the three forms of racism so that we can talk about how to confront a racist Christian. Hold on to that, because I know you're still saying, is it possible to be Christian and a racist, all right? And so we'll get to that. So let's talk about systematic racism. Systematic racism is called systematic for a reason, because it is ingrained, it is interwoven, it is tied into a system. It is tied into government. It is tied into policy. It is tied into business. It is tied into banking. It is tied into how we understand worldview. It is systematic, okay? It is how things function without it necessarily being said. It is systematic. So it's called systematic racism, okay? So let's talk about systematic power. All right, systematic power. For an example, systematic power and how racism shows up in systematic power. For an example, in 1865, the Emancipation Proclamation was stated, and slavery officially was supposed to end in 1865 after Lincoln read the Emancipation Proclamation. September the 22nd in 1864, it was supposed to be enacted on January 1st, 1865. However, some slaves in the South still did not get the word that we were emancipated. That's why we celebrate Juneteenth. That's coming up this weekend, all right? So then now, watch this. So 1865, slavery was supposed to end. So then, once slavery was ended, or what we know as involuntary servitude, all right, free labor, then what some decided to do with their power and their authority, they said, if we cannot work people under the law of slavery, what we will do is begin to charge people with trumped up charges. And I use that word intentionally. And so they started finding free slaves. They started charging them with jaywalking and finding criminal charges for no reasons for many years. And they started penalizing them and criminalizing the freed slaves for almost nothing, and then they institutionalized them. Go with me for a second, okay? They institutionalized them and then made them work from the prison system. And today, we call that same labor work release. Are y'all hearing me? That is a system of power, but it was on the system of racism, because it was the superior race doing it to the dark-skinned race at that time. That's what they called it, or the black race, all right, predicated on skin color alone, white supremacy, doing that to the dark race. That was systemic racism. An example of that, and it's playing out today, all right? So that's an example of systemic power, all right? Systemic power is tied into the system that we can do this because of who we are, all right? Then there is systemic wealth. That is wealth that is passed down by a race of people that just walk into wealth. And they don't necessarily do anything to get it, but they get it because of a skin complexion, systemic wealth. Give you an example. In the early 30s and the 40s, there were federal programs, governmental programs, that was privy for the white race that was not privy for the black race. there were some programs that blacks could not qualify for, predicated on their race, that whites could. And so many of those programs that were granted to them in the 30s and the 40s, what is actually revealed in this book, some of this information I got out of this book, what is revealed in this book is that it shows that many of those programs help build the upper middle white class today. So then now, what we find is that much of the wealth of that class today came from the programs that were built in the 30s and the 40s back then. That's why in 2009, the wealth of the average white family in the assets was $113,149. And the wealth of the average black family in 2009 was $5,677. So then now, you're talking about systemic wealth, systemic poverty. And then some have the nerve to say, pull up your own bootstraps. Well, you can pull up your bootstraps if you were given boots and straps, but it's hard to pull up yourself with your own bootstraps when you were never given boots or straps. Are y'all hearing me? And I'm not talking about being victims. Yes, we have had opportunities. Yes, we are able to do some things now. I am talking about a system that has been constructed and built up against you, and then now you're still asked to compete on the same playing ground. Systemic power, systemic wealth, systemic access. All right, systemic access. I'll give you an example. We're talking about systemic racism, systemic access right here in this city. Let's just talk about right here in this city. Systemic access. We're talking about systems. Right here in our city, if you drive down Interstate 40, let's just go to Interstate 40. For those of you who live in Kernersville, all the way to Clemens, North Carolina, right? You go down Interstate 40, there's a hospital at every exit. Starting in Kernersville, traveling west, all right? There's a hospital at every exit, right? You go, then you get to the mall. From the mall, then you get to Clemens. From Clemens, then you go up the next exit, a Tanglewood exit. Then you, from there, you go down. Then you all the way down to Davis County. There's a hospital, a medical facility at every exit. But if you go Highway 52, all right, that runs north and south through the black community, all right, East Winston, there is not one medical facility, not one medical facility in north part of Winston-Salem. Systemic access, all right, there's a problem, which means that if you live in the northern part of Winston and if you have a heart attack at 2 o'clock in the morning, you may have to drive 20 minutes to get to a hospital. Whereas if you live down Interstate 40, you may have to drive 3 minutes to get to the hospital. That's not fair. Let's go here, because many of you know me. I love God. I love the church. I love my community, and I love truth. And we just got to hold each other accountable that we have a CVS in East Winston that's doing, that they have other locations in our city, and they're doing COVID tests in other locations in our city, in white communities. And we have had to pull teeth to get them to do COVID tests in the black community where they're located. They are located on Martin Luther King Jr. Drive. You would think that since COVID is hitting the African-American community at a rate that is not hitting other communities. It's hitting the Latino community and our community at rates that is not hitting other communities. You would think that by you being on Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, that that would be the first site that they would do testing. And we have had to pull teeth. We have had to meet and beg and ask them to do testing. And I am talking about systemic racism. And if you're spending your dollars there, you owe them to ask them why didn't they consider that site first before they were going to other communities? Is it possible to be a Christian and racist? We're going to get there in just a few minutes. Stay with me. You better call somebody. You better tell them, hey, we getting into it tonight. We getting into it today. We getting into it, all right? Racism as system. But then let's talk about systemic racism as implicit bias. All right? Now, implicit bias is hardwired in the unconscious mind for perceived differences. Okay? It is where the prejudice comes from. All right? This is 90% of racism is practiced under the guise of implicit bias. 90%. So for an example, implicit bias is this. So we attach certain meanings to certain things. So it is possible for a person to be saved, all right? Because to be saved means that you confess with your mouth, Romans 10:9, the Lord Savior Jesus Christ, and believe in your heart that Christ raised him from the dead, and thou shalt be saved, right? We all agree with that, right? Okay, it's Romans 10:9. It's possible to be saved, but the color black still has some meaning in your brain. That's why Paul says in Romans 6:1, be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's why it's not enough for you to get saved, but you must be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So it's possible to be saved, but black still have a negative meaning in your mind. As a matter of fact, for many people, black still have a negative meaning. Look at all that black means today, all right? The negative meaning attached to black. Black bald, killer black shark, black widow spider, black cat, all right? Black male, black sheep of the family, all right? Black market, right? So then that's why Black Lives Matter movement is so powerful, because they have come and redefined what black means. That's why in 2016, some of the political campaign leaders tried to redefine Black Lives Matter to say all lives matter, because black was too negative for them. And anybody now that tries to redefine what Black Lives Matter mean, you correct them and you say to them, no, this is not an All Lives Matter movement. This is a Black Lives Matter movement. Because for so long, black has been labeled negative. That's why James Brown came on the scene years ago and said this right here. Watch this, James Brown gonna say, say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. Watch this right here.
James Brown's I'm Black and I'm Proud was, it was an affirmation of self-respect. And it was a challenge to others to respect themselves and to respect him. Brother, we can't quit until we get
everybody was trying to think of what to say about Martin Luther King getting shot, about the situation in America, the civil rights movement. Everybody just wanted to know how to capsulize it. And so when James Brown said, "Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud," that said it. That's it. So when he said it, everybody hollered back, "I'm black and I'm proud."
The words were magical. I mean, that was the ultimate emancipation.
Every crisis is an opportunity, and he's one of the few people that took the crisis of 1968 and turned it into an opportunity to really help a generation of people.
Say it loud. I'm black and I'm proud. Man, I could have listened to that all day long. So what James was talking about is that black was beautiful, and we have to reinstill that for ourselves. So then now, Black Lives Matter comes along and picked up where James Brown left off and said, "Black Lives Matter, and it's beautiful." And now the world has come together and they're marching and they're protesting. White, black, Hispanic, Asian, the world, Germans, French, Italians, they're all marching saying Black Lives Matter. They're all but saying, "Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud." The world is saying it. Are y'all hearing me? So here is the deal. Those of you who may not be black, and you are watching this message, and you're saying, "Well, I'm not racist." Well, let's just do a check, okay? You're saying, "I'm Christian and I'm not racist." Well, let's just do a check, okay? If you're a Christian and you say, "I'm not racist because I have two black friends," you got to check that, because there are 48 million black people in America, 48 million, and you only have two. That looks a little racist to me. You might be Christian, but that looks a little racist to me. You got to expand your black friend list. 48 million, and you only got two? You got to look at that, okay? You got to look at that, all right? You may be saying, if you're saying that, okay, well, since we're discussing the black matter and you may know more about this, that's a little racist. Just because I'm black doesn't mean that I always speak for the black matters, okay? And then don't reduce me to just the black information. I know more than just black information. I know something about everything. I really do. I don't know everything, but I know more than just about what's in Ebony Magazine or Essence Magazine or Black Business Magazine. I know other things other than just Black Matters. Okay, if you're a white Christian and you invite me over to your house, please don't say to me, "Please come over to my house and how do you like your fried chicken? You know, how do you want your fried chicken fried?" No. Be careful talking about fried chicken with black people. I'm just trying to help you now, because it's still a racial undertone with that, particularly in the South. You got to be careful with that. Right? Just trying to help you a little bit. So then all of these things are important. All these things I want you to maintain and keep your friendships. All right? Be careful with that. We do believe that you can be saved, but there are times when you do some racial things, some racist things. For those of you who go to, you may have some black people in your church, all right? We don't all shout. We don't all run around the church, all right? We have diverse ways of expressing our spirituality, all right? So understand that, all right? And just know that. We do want to be more than just seen on the praise teams, right? Include us in the boardrooms, get our opinions about how the church should function if black people choose to go to your church. And then for those of you that go to white churches, don't get to white churches and then start looking down on black churches. Because just because it's a white church don't mean that it's better. All right. I just want you to understand that as well. But the idea is that being saved is one thing and you working on racial relations is something else. All right. This week, Rob Parsley had to apologize for some insensitive things that he said to the black community. He claims to be saved, and he's been preaching all these years, and I believe he believes in the resurrection of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, but I believe he has some racial implicit bias ways that he has to work on, all right? So if you are a Christian and you still have some racial things that you got to work on them. Get those things straight, all right? Okay, last but not least, and we're going to end this, is racism as self-delusional hate, all right? This is a serious piece. Look at that picture right there with the officer's knee on George Floyd's neck. This racism will make the dominant race convince themselves that victims are not like them. They don't feel pain the way they do. They're not intelligent, sensitive, or indolent. They're degenerate, violent, and dangerous. This racism is such that they don't think that the other race is even human. As a matter of fact, they will reduce your manhood, your womanhood, and that's why they can treat you that way. The officer who murdered George Floyd practiced hate. He had reduced that man to less than a human that he could treat him any kind of way. And some believe that police brutality is related back to this form of racism and this form of hate. That if I can make you a beast, if I can make you an animal, I can treat you any kind of way. That's deep, man. And let me tell you, this kind of racism is what you will see practiced by KKK. You will hear white supremacists say niggas go back to Africa, when in fact, what history records is that Africans were more than likely here before the Europeans arrived. So if anybody need to go back anywhere, it's not the Africans nor the Native Americans. But this kind of hate is serious, all right? When you talk about the hate, that is the insult of the president going to Tulsa, Oklahoma this week. I want you to know the history behind that. Juneteenth is this week, and Juneteenth is celebrated for African Americans remembering the emancipation of slaves and those who didn't get the word until late. And they're going to be celebrating that this week, but the president chose to go to Tulsa, Oklahoma. In Tulsa, Oklahoma, 99 years ago, 3,200 Klansmen destroyed black-owned businesses, hotels, restaurants, law offices, doctor offices, black-owned, the black Wall Street that blacks had. And they came through and burned those buildings down. They called it a riot, but it wasn't a riot. It was a takeover. 10,000 residents were left homeless. 300 lives were taken or more, but they destroyed that place. and the president has chosen to reignite his rallies in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the place of the most vicious attack on black businesses, black families. He has chosen to start his rallies right there. That is the problem with that particular move. And that, my brothers and my sisters, we believe is a form of systematic racism, systematic hate, and implicit bias. And it is a form of disrespect towards the African-American race. Listen, I hope that this has been a blessing to you, but can you be a Christian and racist? You can be a Christian. Yes, you can. And you can still have some racist ways. But here's how we need to confront that. A, we confront it with truth. Always be willing as a Christian to tell a racist the truth. All right? Tell them the truth. Tell them how you feel. Get it off of your chest. Don't be afraid to confront that. You got to use some wisdom. If you see a person is very hot-headed and evil and mean, sometimes you do have to go back and pray. But when that situation is convenient and they're asking you to tell them the truth, tell them the truth. Confront it with love. We don't harbor any hate in our heart. No, Dr. King talked to us about that. We don't harbor hate. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I love all people. When we were fighting the Dixie Classic Fair, there was a white man who really literally almost attacked me while I was speaking in a public forum. And I wasn't worried because I had my members with me and they were ready to go to bat. But I wasn't worried about that. And even after that confrontation, I really wanted to reach out with that man and go to lunch with him, and I still do. I wasn't mad at him. I knew he was caught up in the system. I had nothing but love in my heart. So I don't hate any man or any woman. We love. We just realize that we're in a system that we gotta fix. You confront with hope. I believe that things are gonna change. I'm so glad to see these young people marching and for change and for difference, because they're determined that the world that they're going to see in the future is not going to be the world they've seen in the past. I got hope for that. And we confront with strength. We're not giving up. We're not turning around. We ain't going to let nobody turn us around. We ain't going to let nobody turn us around. We ain't going to let nobody turn us around. We're going to keep on marching. Keep on marching. Marching, and we're going to get there together. If we stand together. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. I hope that you would pray about contributing a love gift to this ministry. Please do that for us. You can mail it to 1200 North Trade Street. You can also give it by way of technology. You can do that. If you would like to connect with us, please follow us. Go to our website, unionbaptistwsnc.org. Please do that. We would love to stay in touch with you. God bless you, and thank you for connecting with us for Breaking Bread with Bishop. God bless you.
For ourselves. Well, first of all, we want to thank you so much for your generous support so that we can continue to operate in excellence. The following are ways to give tithes and offerings using technology. Use the PushPay app or go to giving page on the Union Baptist website. Use the Cash app, which is $UBC Trade 1200. Use the Givelify app, Union Baptist Church, Winston-Salem. For Rise Up Giving, please use the designated Cash app, $UnionBaptistRiseUp. If you don't use technology for giving, you may bring your tithes, offering, and Rise Up campaign payments on Sundays from 10 a.m. till noon. Envelopes will be available. Or you can mail checks only. No cash, only checks to 1200 North Trade Street, Winston-Salem, North Carolina, 27101. Now, please make a note of the following announcements. Thursdays at 6:30 p.m., it's Breaking Bread with Bishop. Get the family together and have family dinner while watching Bible study. If this is not a convenient time, you can view the video 24 hours a day on our Facebook page, website, or YouTube. Saturday morning worship schedule, 9 a.m. phone line worship, 10 a.m. C2C remix phone line worship, 11 a.m. Saturday Connect worship by Zoom. On Saturday evening, we will have our phone line church conference call at 7 p.m. Our Sunday morning worship schedule, 8:30 a.m. phone line worship, 9 a.m. Sunday school, 10 a.m. virtual worship. Go to the Union Baptist website, YouTube, or Facebook. 12 p.m. service will be broadcast on the Truth Radio Station, 1340 a.m. Please note the new number for our phone line. Dial 774-258-4711. No code needed. Dial straight in. Please continue to visit the Union Baptist website updates page. Click on the Members button. And remember, wash your hands frequently. Avoid large crowds over the size of 10. Cover coughs and sneezes. Stay at home when you're sick. Don't hoard food. The supply chain is fine right now. Have a blessed week.